Welcome everyone. My name is Tim Jackson. This is the CUSP CES lecture for this month, and it's a real pleasure, a particular pleasure, to welcome Lord Adair Turner here for this lecture. For those of you who don't know, there was a period in time at which Adair was both the chair of the Financial Services Agency and the chair of the Climate Change Commission. And that period of time was in the fall of, or one of the parts of that period of time was in the fall of 2009. In fact, Adair, I think, took up that position 5 days after the 15th of September, which was the collapse of Lehman Brothers. And of course, the 3 months into later than that was the Copenhagen Conference of the Parties. And so Adair was almost extraordinarily active in two of the most fundamental aspects of the sustainability of the global economy, exactly the point in time in which either one of them could have created a perfect storm, and one of them certainly did. And I was very struck at a recent meeting where Adair spoke, where he said that he likes to keep those two parts of his life separately, because he couldn't quite handle what might happen if they came together. And so I took a great deal of trouble to try and encourage him to put those two parts of his brain together. And as far as I know, this is the first time, in public at least, that has happened. And he will talk to us about both the financial system. He's just authored this wonderful book with a wonderful title, Between Debt and the Devil, and also a little bit about the implications of that for sustainability. We have about an hour in total. Adair's very kindly agreed that if anyone has one of these books, and you can get them at the bookshop, we have all of the stock in at the bookshop, and would like a signature, Adair's agreed to do that afterwards. But for now, I think I would leave it in his hands to talk to us about debt, growth, and sustainability. Adair, go.
You're turning me on.
Well, I'm going to try. Just put my hand in your pocket.
Could you put your hand in my pocket and turn me on? There we are.
It's a great start.
Is this okay? I mean, is it socially allowed? I mean, it's...
it's all on film.
It's all on film. Good, great, thank you. Tim, thank you very much. And as Tim says, I have been involved in my public life, both with the issues of financial regulation and of climate change. I sometimes say that... what I really love is being involved in the climate change issues. I think that climate change is something which was always bound to be a problem.
Because human prosperity growth was initially based on fossil fuels, and therefore the challenge of how we have a prosperous society without fossil fuels was always, as it were, something in the nature of things, a challenge that we have to meet, whereas the tragedy of what's gone wrong in the financial system is that I think it's a completely avoidable set of self-inflicted wounds, which is why when I was doing both the chairman of the Financial Services Authority and the chairman of the Climate Change Committee, I always used to say to my wife when I came back from climate change days how much I'd enjoyed it and how much of a break it was from working on these issues of the financial system. I am, however, going to talk, as Tim has said, primarily about the financial system today and present some of the key themes of my book, Between Debt and the Devil. But I'm going to try and link it in a way which I don't in the book itself to these issues of sustainability. And in that, I'll actually refer to another book that I wrote 3 years ago called Economics After the Crisis. It's a very slim book, and it's simply the book of three lectures I gave, what I call the Lionel Robbins Memorial Lectures at the LSE, where I did, to a greater extent, try and pull these themes together. Funnily enough, actually, in Between Debt and the Devil, I did originally have a chapter which struggled with the issue of what are the objectives? Should we be setting economic growth as an objective? How does that change what I am saying? But I found that I was just trying to do too many things in the book, and in the process of rewriting the book and cutting it down by about 15 to 20% and making it a better book, I took that out to simplify the story. And sometimes you have to do that, and my publisher urged me to do it, to make a book which is more straightforward and which tells one story well rather than dealing with everything. But I welcome the opportunity to try to link what I say in Between Death and the Devil with some of the issues about what are the fundamental objectives of economic activity. If we begin by assuming that we do want a growing economy, then the last 8 years have clearly been a global economy in deep malaise. Because if you take the formal standard measure of living standards, GDP per capita, the Eurozone isn't even back to the pre-crisis peak. America is about 15% below where it would have been on pre-crisis trends. The UK is slightly above the pre-crisis peak, but only just. And this is a huge break to what we used to assume was the inevitability that the capitalist market system, even though it had its ups and downs year by year, would produce prosperity growth in that measured form of GDP per capita, you know, pretty much inevitably over a decadal time span. But clearly there is something gone wrong with this market economy, and something which was really not anticipated at all by the central banks, by the finance ministries, even after the crisis of autumn 2008. In January 2009, when the extreme period of the crisis was passed, if you looked at the forecasts that the Bank of England or the Treasury or the World Bank or the IMF were producing about world growth, none of them foresaw what a deep post-crisis malaise we would be stuck in. If you looked at market forecasts of interest rates, nobody anticipated that 8 years after the crisis we would have interest rates set by the major central banks essentially at zero and increasingly at negative. And indeed this morning the Swedish central bank has taken its interest rate even more into negative territory, as the Japanese central bank did 2 years ago. So this is a huge unanticipated set of developments, and I think the most fundamental reason why it's occurred can be summed up in this chart. Whoops, this chart, I pressed the button and it worked before, but why is it not working now? When I did that, this chart, which shows debt as a percent of GDP, and this is not public debt, this is not the debt of government, this is private debt, household and corporate debt, as a percent of GDP in all the advanced economies together from 1950 to 2010. And as you can see, it increased from about 50% of GDP in 1950 to 170% in 2007, and it increased pretty much every single year from 1950 to 2007, and at an accelerating pace after the mid-1990s. What is interesting about that growth of leverage as we call it, debt to GDP, is that as it occurred, that raised very few alarm bells among orthodox economics and finance. Among the finance theorists, you could find lots of people who explained to us why economies needed debt contracts as well as equity contracts, and they had a theory that if countries had too few debt contracts, if they didn't have enough what was called financial deepening, that would be bad for growth. So there's a man called Ross Levine, who in a very good review of the literature in 2005 said, look, there are econometric analysis would illustrate that if we look at India, which in 1980 had debt to GDP of 10%, if it had had 50% debt to GDP, it would have grown faster. All the finance literature was about the problems of countries with too little debt, not too much. As for the macroeconomists, the people who think about monetary theory, the determinants of interest rates and inflation, they largely ignored this because they had developed a set of monetary theories in which you could assume that as long as the central bank achieved low and stable inflation by moving the interest rate, you really didn't have to pay much attention to the details of the financial system. That may seem an extraordinary thing to say, but in another version of this, I set up a chart which has quotes from Olivier Blanchard, the former chief economist of the IMF, from Mervyn King, the former governor of the Bank of England, which says, we simply assumed that we could ignore the details of the financial system and the size of what are called monetary aggregates, the total balance sheets of the banks. What is interesting about those attitudes, that this growth in leverage was either benign or was neutral, is that it might have been legitimate, it might have been correct, if the two things that our textbooks tend to say about banks and credit were correct. If you read an economic textbook, I really am intrigued by this, you hit the button, do I have to keep the button down? Do I have to... Oh, no? If you read an economic textbook of banks and bank lending, it will tend to say that banks take money, deposits, from implicitly households, and that they lend it on to businesses, thus achieving capital investment in alternative capital investment projects. There's a lot of discussion in the literature about whether banks do that allocation of capital in a good fashion or not. The trouble is, and the central problem which my book Between Debtor and Devil is dealing with in theory, is that as descriptions of what banks do in modern economies, those two statements are fictional. They're just wrong. They're wrong for two reasons. Banks do not just take pre-existing money and lend it on. Banks create credit, money, and purchasing power which did not previously exist. And understanding that is fundamental to understanding the dynamics of modern monetary economies. Given that they create credit, money, and purchasing power, it matters hugely to whom they lend the credit and therefore to whom they grant the purchasing power. And although they can do that to a degree, lending money to entrepreneurs stroke businesses to fund capital investment projects, actually a lot of what they do is either lend to consumers so that consumers can consume ahead of their income flows. That may be, under certain circumstances, a beneficial thing to do, but it has got nothing to do with the allocation of capital between alternative capital investment projects. But actually, the vast majority of what banks do in modern economies is something different, which is they lend money to companies and individuals to finance a competition between companies and individuals for the ownership of assets that already exist, and in particular for the ownership of real estate assets. Now, when I say that in some environments, people say, well, yes, Adair, but you're British, you know, and British people are mad about buying houses and have a large mortgage market, but it isn't true of the rest of the world, but it is true of the rest of the world. And this is a wonderful piece of empirical analysis from three fine economists, Alan Taylor, Maurice Schulerich, and Oscar Yorda, who've looked at the banking systems of all the advanced economies going back to 1870 and worked out what they lend their money to. And ignore the volatility in the first half of the 20th century, because when you have hyperinflations and wars, some weird things can happen to the figures. But the big story, which they themselves sum up, the big conclusion that they take from their figures is as following. With very few exceptions, the bank's primary business did indeed consist of non-mortgage lending to companies in as late as 1928 or 1970. But by 2007, banks in most countries had turned primarily into real estate lenders. The intermediation of household saving for productive investment in the business sector, which is the standard textbook role of the financial sector, constitutes only a minor share of the business of banking today. Now, that is a fact. It is a fact largely ignored in a lot of our standard textbook accounts, and it is a fact with huge implications for our understanding of instability in modern economies. Why does it matter? It matters because if most credit is financed to buy existing assets, and if those assets are primarily real estate assets, and if those real estate assets are in inelastic supply, because they are locationally specific, right? More value is attached to the hotel on the beach than a mile away from the beach. More value is attached to the office in the place which is convenient for people to get to. More value is attached to the house in the nice part of town or close to the station for an easy commute rather than far away from it. Then, when we extend more credit, all that will tend to happen, or the primary element of what will happen, is more credit will induce an increase in the asset price, the price of housing, which will then induce in the mind of both the lender and the borrower the expectation that house prices will go up, which will then convince them that lending and borrowing some more money is a good thing, which will then produce a further increase in the price of real estate. And it turns out that these cycles of credit against existing real estate, more credit against more existing real estate on the upswing, and then a crisis of confidence where people no longer have confidence that house prices are going to go up and it all swings into a reverse spiral, they are not just part of the story of financial instability in modern economies, but they are, as been illustrated in some very fine bits of work by Claudio Borio, who is at the Bank for International Settlements, they are again and again 90% of the story of why we have financial crisis and why we have instability in modern economies, why we have booms and then recessions. It's the story of why Japan has a boom in the 1980s and then a bust from which it's never really recovered in the 1990s. It's the story of the Scandinavian financial system crash in the early 1990s, and it's the story of Ireland and Spain and the UK and the US in the run-up to 2007. And the problem is that if you have those run-ups and then the reverse, the run-down, we enter a situation where the debt never really goes away. It just shifts around the world, and where it appears that all our tools for getting the economy going again are either blocked or have adverse side effects. The debt doesn't go away, it simply moves around the economy. We ought to have known that that might occur because there was a canary in the mine, and the canary was Japan. In the 1980s, Japan had just about the biggest ever of these credit and real estate booms. The price of commercial real estate in central Tokyo goes up 3 or 4 times in the course of 5 years. The amount of credit extended goes up 2.5 times in those 5 years. But then it goes too high. There is a crack of confidence in 1990. House prices, and in particular commercial real estate prices, collapse. And you have a whole load of companies, and in Japan's case it was much more companies than individuals, who feel that they are overborrowed, they are overleveraged. And they hit the brakes. They cut investment. And that drives the economy into a recession. And they're so determined to pay down their debt that they keep on trying to pay down their debt, even when the Bank of Japan cuts the interest rate to zero. Now, when that happens, something happens which is a useful and naturally arising offset to it, which is that the government starts running deficits because the companies cut their investment, the economy goes into a recession, tax revenues go down, social expenditure goes up, the government begins to run a deficit, and that is naturally arising, and initially it's very useful because the stimulus of the fiscal deficit helps offset the deleveraging of the private sector, but with the inevitable consequence that the debt doesn't go away. It simply moves from the private sector to the public sector. And indeed, the story of Japan over the last 25 years can be summed up on this chart. The red line is corporate debt to GDP, which you can see slowly coming down from 150% to 100%, while public debt to GDP goes up from 50% to 250% and still rising. The debt doesn't go away, it just shifts around from the private to the public sector. And that pattern, which we see in Japan, has been repeated in all the developed economies since 2008. The red line shows, this is all developed economies together, a slight deleveraging of the household sector, primarily in the US. It shows for the corporate sector, the blue line, at least no further increase in leverage, and it shows for the green line, a very significant increase in public debt. And if you put the public debt and the private debt together, which is the top line here for the developed economies, you can see that it hasn't come down at all. It's gone up further. And this was set out beautifully in a report, what's called the Geneva Report, with the great title, Deleveraging, What Deleveraging? There has been no deleveraging in the global economy since 2008. There has also, in addition to a major shift within the developed economies of the debt from the private sector to the public sector, there's been a big shift to the red line there, which is the debt of the emerging economies, and in particular China. And that's not just a coincidence, it followed directly from the overcreation of private debt in the developed world before 2008. Because what happened was that the Chinese authorities in early 2009 were terrified that deleveraging by overleveraged US households was going to reduce demand for their exports and therefore reduce employment in their manufacturing sector. And to offset that, the Chinese launched a huge credit-fueled investment boom, a huge credit-fueled investment boom, which is now coming to an inevitable end. And it is the end of that huge credit-fueled investment boom which is having these very big effects on commodity markets and growth across the whole world today. So we end up trapped with this too much debt. Trying to get rid of it in one place means more debt in another place, but that then creates another crisis, and then we end up stuck in this malaise of slow growth, low inflation, low interest rates. And in that environment, it appears that all our classic levers for dealing with growth, for getting growth going, are blocked. In the initial aftermath of the crisis of 2008, at the G20 meeting in April 2009 in London, the G20 leaders all agreed that they should run simultaneous fiscal deficits to stimulate the economy. And there's no doubt at all that the initial effect of that was stimulative. But after a year or so of that, everybody began to worry about rising public debt levels, so they introduced austerity, fiscal consolidation. And you can understand why they did that, but the trouble is that if you try to do fiscal consolidation at the same time that the private sector is still trying to delever, you will drive the economy into a deep recession, unless the central bankers come along and say, no, no, we can fix this with ultra-loose monetary policy. So you, the government, do tight fiscal policy. We'll offset it with ultra-loose monetary policy, with zero or negative interest rates, with quantitative easing to bring down the long end of the yield curve. But the trouble is that the transmission mechanism of all that through to the real economy is pretty indirect, a little unclear, and has adverse side effects. Once people feel that they are over-leveraged, that they've got too much debt and don't have confidence in the future, and once you've already got interest rates down to 1 or 0.5%, cutting interest rates down to zero doesn't make all that much difference. People's investment, in particular company investment, is just not that elastic. It's not that sensitive to further small falls in interest rates. So we then sometimes say, oh, no, no, the transmission mechanism is through asset values. We bring down the interest rate, equity prices go up, bond prices go up. The only trouble is that creates a huge vulnerability. You push up equity prices, people feel a bit more confident, maybe people start spending a bit more, companies start investing a bit more. But the very fact that you've pumped up the equity prices to a high level makes it vulnerable to a crack of confidence, the crack of confidence which we're seeing over the last 2 months. Indeed, the central irony of ultra-loose monetary policy as a way of getting us out of this debt overhang is that it can only ultimately work by re-stimulating the very growth of private credit that got us into the mess in the first place. So we seem to be stuck with a situation, what's called a debt overhang, a level of debt in the world where we seem to be stuck with an unavoidable choice. Either we're going to be stuck up for years, decades, with sustained low growth and low inflation, with debt burdens that never decline, all we're going to have to do, and some people say this, debt write-offs. We've actually got to take Greek debt, Italian debt, write it down. Mortgage debt, write it down to sustainable levels. Or it seems we've got to keep ultra-low interest rates for a long period of time. Negative interest rates makes existing debt more affordable, but with the ironic effect that it creates all sorts of incentives for people to pile up new debt, so you never get out of the debt overhang. Now, that is my analysis of why we are where we are in economic terms today. And there are then two issues for public policy, still sticking, and then I'm going to widen it out a bit to the sustainability today, still sticking to the issue of just the financial system itself, and still working within the paradigm that real growth would be a good idea. And those two questions are, how do we make sure that we grow the economies without producing too much debt in the first place? Can we grow the economies without creating excessive amounts of debt? And the second question, which is part four of my book, and part five of my book is, yeah, but given we didn't do that in the past, what the hell are we going to do about all this debt that we've got in the world today? On the first of these questions, I address in my book the following dilemma. We seem to have a sort of dependence on debt which is self-destructive. You can characterize the 20 or so years of the advanced economies before the crisis on the top two lines of this chart. We were growing nominal GDP, which is the combination of real GDP and inflation, at about 4 or 5% per annum, and relatively steadily. And the central bankers of the world were patting themselves on the back and saying, that's just right, we like inflation at 2%, not 5% or zero. 2% real growth, that's sort of what advanced economies can do, and it's relatively stable. This was the great moderation. But throughout that period, private credit to GDP was growing at about 10 to 15% per annum. So leverage was increasing. But it seemed at the time that we almost needed that private credit to GDP in order to achieve a reasonable growth of nominal GDP. And one of the questions I ask in the book is that true? Have we got something self-destructive about the modern monetary economy where it can only grow at a reasonable rate with a still faster rate of credit growth, which eventually produces crisis? I argue in the book, no, that's not true. That we can have economies which grow with, let's say, nominal GDP growing at about 5% per annum and credit growing at about 5% per annum, but that to get there, we have to do two things. First, we have to address some fundamentals of why our economies are so credit intensive. And in the interest of time, I'm just going to put these three up there, and you can ask me questions about them later, or you can read the book, because subtly, I do have to leave you with reasons to read the book. I think it is the case that if we have an increasingly unequal society, we have a society where demand only balances with a rising level of credit. And indeed, one of the people who is, I quote, who shows that on an empirical basis is Michael Kumhoff, who is sitting over there, a very fine paper which he has produced with Roman Rancière. It is also the case that there's something fundamental, and we can come back to this, about the role of real estate in modern economies. This is inherent. There's something about modern economies where more of all, a higher proportion of all investment is going to take the form of investing in real estate, not plant and machinery, essentially because plant and machinery is getting ever cheaper because of the progress of information and communications technology. And it's also the case that there's something about spending money on real estate, which is a completely rational thing to humans to do, because where you live is an incredibly important determinant of your standard of living. So over time, we tend to devote more of our income to competing with one another to determine who gets to live in the nicer places. And that's a logical thing for people to spend an increasing propension of their money on if they've already got to the stage where they've got as much food, they've got as much clothing, they've got as much heat, they've got as many televisions as they want. It is a high income elasticity activity. But those things then have big consequences, which I explore in my book. Finally, there's an issue of global imbalances. It is a simple mathematical fact that if Germany is running, as it is today, a current account surplus of 8.3% of GDP, unless that is fully matched by purchases by Germans of equities or real property in other countries, it is bound to be matched somewhere in the rest of the world by debt, much of which may turn out to be unsustainable. So we will need to address those fundamentals to have a less credit-intensive economy. But I argue that we will also need a new philosophy of monetary policy and of financial regulation. I believe that monetary aggregates matter, that we were wrong to ignore the growth of bank balance sheets as a percent of GDP. But I think they matter for a completely different reason than the monetarists assumed. Monetarists assumed that money, which is the liability side of the banking system, that the growth of money was a good forward indicator of inflation. Turned out not to be. Instead, the growth of credit, which is the asset side of the bank balance sheet, turned out to be a good forward indicator of excessive leverage, crisis, debt overhang, post-crisis depression and deflation. Monetary aggregates matter, and the mix of debt by category matters. The economic function of debt which finances investment, whether it's in actual real estate construction or plant and machinery, debt which finances consumption, and debt which finances the purchase of existing scarce supply assets, these are three completely different functions in our economy which we have glossed over and failed to explore adequately in most standard pre-crisis economic theory. And it is reflecting this that we are increasingly seeing around the world, and this is from the OECD this June, papers which are beginning to realize that we were wrong to assume that more debt is good for the economy. What the OECD is suggesting is that up to a certain point, credit as a percent of GDP is positive for growth, that beyond a point, it turns negative. And increasingly, I am suggesting that we have to think about a function which, as it were, reconciles, as I call it, Ross Levine, whom I quoted earlier, and OECD, that up to some point, increasing financial intensity is indeed good for growth, for productivity, for social welfare. That it really was true that India would have done better with a more developed financial system in 1980, but beyond a certain level, more finance, and in particular, more debt as a percent of GDP, is bad. But up that vertical axis, I put growth, productivity, and social welfare. But am I right to do that? Because up until now, the whole of my talk has been assuming that the objective is growth. And I now want to challenge that. I've been saying that most debt is not needed to drive growth. I've skimmed over that, but basically I do argue that we can grow without debt, and that too much debt creates a debt overhang which traps us in slow growth. But what if maximum growth is not a desirable objective? That is the issue which I addressed in my first of my Lionel Robbins lectures, which is the first chapter of this book. And like many people, I observed the fact that beyond a certain level of per capita GDP, it doesn't seem as if there is a good correlation between real per capita GDP and some, as best we can measure it, measure of human utility or happiness. Now, there are big debates in these measures about whether self-reported happiness works and how we measure this, but there is an accumulation of evidence that suggests that we should doubt the idea that real GDP is the thing we should always pursue. And I argue in this book that essentially, if we put economic and technological progress and GDP per capita in its normal standard measured sense up the right-hand side, and if we put economic and technological progress on the horizontal axis, and we put either GDP per capita or contentment, utility, welfare, whatever we think it is, up the vertical axis, that there is a disconnect. That as you go from pre-industrial societies to industrial societies, the income line and the utility line move together, but you get to a point, and it's the point where the advanced economies probably reached 20 or 30 or 40 years ago, where there is a disconnect and higher income does not necessarily produce more human well-being, contentment, or happiness. I also argue in the book that we have to understand that different categories of growth, different categories of things to which we might devote our productive capability, our ability to do things more productively, have different implications for human welfare. People, when I say, look, I'm not convinced that further growth in GDP per capita is good for human welfare, say, but you know, what about better health? We need growth for better health services. Surely that's good for human welfare. And yes, I do believe that you know, we have the ability to take productivity, growth, and turn it into health. But I think there's some other things in the middle where the productive process of capitalism simply leaves us going round and round and round. Broadly speaking, there are a lot of branded goods, fashion goods, style goods, where I think it's better to live in a society where people can think of new fashions each year and try to persuade us to join, buy them, a new restaurant format each year, trying to persuade us to go to this one or that one. But any idea that 20 years later, that the fashions of 20 years later are going to make us fundamentally and permanently better off than the fashions of today is just not true. It's a perfectly legitimate thing to do, but it's a cycle that goes round and round. It has no sort of, the more better we do this, the more that we have fundamental welfare. And then there are other issues to do with congestion and environmental bads, where unless we are very careful, we will produce harm by higher productivity and higher growth and higher material growth. And of course, this is the stuff that Tim has written about. Finally, on what do I believe, and then I'm going to relate this to debt. My overall position on growth in already rich countries is as following. I believe that growth in average per capita GDP now has diminished potential or less certain potential to deliver human welfare. I do, however, believe that the combination of human ingenuity plus economic freedom will produce a rise in productivity, which will tend to produce growth. I think it's good to allow people to choose where they work, what they do, whether they come up with new ideas. And I think if you allow that, we will inevitably produce something which is called growth. And I think different forms of growth have different potential to increase human welfare. Therefore, I believe that maximizing growth should not be the objective. But I do believe economic freedom is valuable in itself and will tend to produce growth, but we should not get fixated as to whether growth is 1.5 or 1.6 or 1.8, and that public policy needs to ensure that the harmful potential impacts of growth are minimized and that the positive impacts of measured growth are maximized. How does that then relate to the issue of debt? Debt is an apparently low-risk claim on future money income. But both private credit creation and public political processes can create too much debt, too many apparently low-risk claims on future money income than makes sense given the likely development of future money income. We can, as it were, create too many apparently low-risk claims in the future. This can leave economies stuck in a debt overhang trap. And this problem is more likely to be severe if future money growth prospects are either reduced for bad reasons, because we're simply stuck in a trap that we don't know our way out of, or should be reduced for good reasons, because we don't want to be on this treadmill of saying it's desperately important to make the real growth rate 2%, not 1.5%. And what that says is, if maximum growth should not be the objective, or if there are reasons like demography where absolute growth as measured is going to be more difficult, we should be even more wary of accumulating excessive debt in the first place. But how does that conclusion then finally adjust what I said were the policy implications? What are the policy implications about preventing harmful credit growth? I argued earlier that we need to prevent harmful credit growth build-ups, credit build-ups, by fixing the fundamentals. And again, I'm not going to go through in details that, but we need to do things about inequality, about the role of real estate in modern economies, about global imbalances, so that we don't have over-credit-intensive economies. I also think we need radically changed financial regulation, which uses the power of regulation to damp down the overcreation of debt. And that is much higher bank capital requirements than we agreed, and I was involved in agreeing in endless negotiations in what was called the Financial Stability Board before 2009 and 2010. Much stronger counter-cyclical capital levers, limits on loan to value and loan to income loans on mortgage debt, etc., and risk weights to reflect social risk, not private risk. I, for instance, argue that there is a natural tendency of the banking system left to itself, which you cannot criticize the banks themselves for, because it's completely rational, seen from a private point of view, to overlend against real estate and potentially to underlend against some categories of investment. Therefore, we should not allow the risk weights, what's called the risk weights, how much capital a bank needs to set against a particular category of lending, to be entirely set by private initiative. We ought to lean against the naturally over-bias towards real estate with policies. And once you've said that, it also raises the question of, could we use things like capital requirements and risk weights also deliberately to favour those forms of investment or growth which we think are more sustainable? If I switch on my climate change hat, there is a very strong belief among economists in relation to climate change that we should use the pricing of what's called externalities through, for instance, a carbon price, to use the power of the market to discourage harmful carbon pollution. We set a higher price for carbon. That will send system decentralized messages into the market economy, which will make every company be a bit more cautious about producing carbon. But once you realise that it is reasonable for the public policy to intervene through a price of carbon in the product markets, there's no fundamental reason why we shouldn't also use some interventions in our capital regulation or our risk weight regulation to favour more sustainable forms of capital investment. Finally, however, what on earth are we going to do about the level of debt that we have already? Because we have too many claims. It appears that we are stuck out of ammunition. Ultra-loose monetary policy can only ultimately work by reigniting private credit growth. Have a look at these figures from the UK Office of Budget Responsibility, produced last year. The red line is UK household gross debt as a percent of income. The blue line is UK public debt as a percent of GDP. Over the last 4 years, we've achieved some deleveraging of private debt, as you can see, down from 165 to 140% of GDP, but that has been more than offset by a rise in public debt. The OBR says that George Osborne's plans for fiscal consolidation are about to start working and public debt is going to stop going up, but it also says that that is only going to be compatible with a growing economy if private debt, having gone down to 140%, turns round and by 2020 is back to as high as it ever was, with the two together, a higher level than it has ever been. Again, the debt doesn't go away, it just moves around. So we have the problem that ultra-loose monetary policy can ultimately work by reigniting private credit growth. Fiscal policy could stimulate the economy, and we could skew it towards more sustainable ends in an environmental sense, but it appears blocked by public debt sustainability concerns. People say that we are out of ammunition, but if our problem is an inadequacy of nominal demand, that is one of the very few problems in economics to which there is always an answer, because we can always run fiscal deficits which are financed by the creation of central bank money. Now, when I say that, this is where my orthodox establishment friends, central bankers, think that I've, gone AWOL, gone mad, broken the taboo, because you're not meant to say that money finance of fiscal deficits is ever allowable. But I'm in some good, as it were, orthodox company, because Milton Friedman said it in 1948 and in 1960, and Milton Friedman's not exactly known as a sort of mad left-wing socialist inflation lover, a pretty sound fellow according to the orthodoxy in terms of low inflation and private markets, but he said the chief function of the monetary authority should be the creation of money to meet government deficits. And in 1960, he said, if you get stuck in what's called a liquidity trap and you can't get the economy going through any other means, you should fill a helicopter with dollar bills, scatter them on the ground, and it'll get them going again. Well, that's not what you do in the real economy. You'd actually say, I'm going to use central bank money in a highly disciplined fashion, only in small amounts and determined by the authority of the central bank, to get up to the inflation target, with the government then deciding whether it spends that money on a tax cut or on a public expenditure increase, which it could, if it wants, also skew to achieve other aspects of sustainability. So Milton Friedman said it, a man called Henry Simons, an absolute founding father of the Chicago School of Free Market Economics, said the same in 1936. And it's what Ben Bernanke told. Ben Bernanke, former governor of the Federal Reserve Bank, not, again, unorthodox, a non-establishment figure. It's what he clearly told the Japanese people to do, the Japanese authorities to do in 2003. The fundamental point to realize about monetary finance is that it is absolutely possible to do, and there are no technical reasons why we cannot do it. But there is a political risk, and the political risk is that once we accept that monetary finance is possible, we've broken a taboo and we've opened ourselves up to temptation. Because if governments can print money to cut taxes or increase public expenditure, why will politicians not want to do it all the time and in excessive quantities rather than in appropriately disciplined amounts in appropriate circumstances. Which is why in a paper I gave to the IMF Research Conference in November this year, I entitled my paper, "The Case for Monetary Finance, an Essentially Political Issue." There is no technical reason why you cannot use this both to stimulate the economy and, if you want, to achieve other sustainability objectives, but there are huge political risks against which you have to guard. I believe those political risks can be guarded against by an appropriate design of rules and institutions. But some people are worried that you can't guard against that. And particularly when I give this lecture in Germany, it takes about 5 minutes before we get into questions where somebody mentions the Weimar Republic and hyperinflation and the overcreation of money. And they're quite right to be worried that these things can be overdone. And actually that is why my book has this rather odd title, Between Debt and the Devil. The devil is up there in the top right-hand corner. He's called Mephistopheles, and he's the figure for the devil in Wolfgang von Goethe's Faust Part II, one of the great works of German literature. And Mephistopheles in Faust Part II tempts the emperor, and he says, "Emperor, you don't need to be constrained in your public expenditures because you can print as much money as you want." But unfortunately, it ends in excessive inflation. And in autumn 2012, Jens Weidmann, the president of the Bundesbank, gave a speech in which he got pretty close to suggesting that Mario Draghi, the head of the ECB, was beginning to grow a pair of horns, because Mario was beginning to discuss the possibility of QE. And Jens gave a speech which said, "Be very wary once you go down that path of printing money. You'll never give up. You'll be like an alcoholic who, once they have one glass of wine, wants another and another and another." That's the risk you've got to guard against, the political risk that we overdo monetary finance. But we also need to guard against the fact that if we simply rely on an entirely free market system to create debt, it will create too much debt and the wrong sort of debt in a way that can be harmful both for economic sustainability and environmental sustainability. And that is why, Michael, that is why my book is called Between Debt and the Devil. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. It's in some ways a shame that Michael Kumov just walked out of the door. He might have picked you up on your story of the Weimar Republic. It's quite interesting. He has a sense that actually the story of so-called hyperinflation in the Weimar Republic was not a public policy disaster actually at all. It was a failure within private institutions. So it was, in a sense, you know, handing over the power of Mephistopheles to private institutions looks a lot more dangerous than handing it over to possibly state interests. But it's a fantastic tour through a complex territory that is so relevant to the success of the economy today and the sustainability of society tomorrow. I'm sure there's a lot of questions to ask. I'm not sure we will get round with microphones, but it'll hold things up a little bit. So if you could raise your voice and tell us who you are as well, as you ask the question.
Yeah. Michael Parker from the Candy of Finance. Concerned with your book, people always worry about the left-wing solution to things, the ideological position of the right-wing with monetarism seems to have grown two heads as opposed to two horns, in that quantitative easing is okay as long as you give the money to the bank. Give it to anybody else, it's horrific.
Shall I answer each one in turn, or should we take two or three? Okay, look, I actually think this idea that QE, I am arguing for a different approach to QE than is going on at the moment, but I do not think that the problem is well summed up by the statement that QE gives the money to the banks. I mean, this money, let's be clear, is non-interest-bearing reserves at the Bank of England, right? There is no particular value for a bank of having non-interest-bearing reserves at the Bank of England. I mean, the way it gets there is a bank previously owned, you know, a gilt, a 1 or 2% interest-bearing bond owed by the British government, and the Bank of England came along and said, no, don't hold that. Here, you have some non-interest-bearing money. So that's what's happened. And I think you can see that to describe that as it were, a sort of gift to the bank or the bankers, you know, doesn't really capture the reality. And the idea is not that this is a gift to the bank. It's that the banks will then lend it out to the real economy. And the Bank of England argues, and I think it has a reasonable case, that its first rounds of QE did produce some lending to the real economy, and that both the rate of inflation and the rate of growth were somewhat higher as a result of its $375 billion of QE than it would otherwise have been. So I do think that, I know it's a nice piece of slogan that, you know, QE was given to the banks, not the people, but I think actually, to be blunt, you know, as a piece of technical analysis, it's not a good description of it. I just think that QE, beyond a certain level, has diminishing marginal returns and is unlikely to be effective. I think it will only work by keeping interest rates so low that people are tempted to borrow more money, but if they're over-leveraged already, that's a problem. I think it might work by pushing up the value of assets, whether bonds or equities, but as I've said, that can make us vulnerable to a crack of confidence that brings the equity values down. And if it does succeed through that, has the rather ironic effect of increasing inequality. And given that one of the reasons why I think we had too much debt in the first place is rising inequality, it's a bit ironic to try and solve it with yet more inequality. So my argument is the problem with QE is it doesn't, and this is a Milton Friedman term, it doesn't get directly into the income stream. It doesn't directly stimulate the economy. It attempts to do it through these indirect and potentially adverse effects. So I think there are good arguments for saying we can't just get the economy going again by QE or negative interest rates. And that's what I've been arguing. And that's why I'm arguing that there are circumstances in which you have to do a fiscal stimulus, which is actually monetary finance. But I argue that without using this phrase, QE has given the money to the banks, because, you know, nice polemic phrase, but I don't think as a piece of technical analysis, it's a good description.
There must be surely at least an element of you made a very strong case that debt gets pushed around, but the financial system as a whole has zero net financial worth, which means that assets also get pushed around, and assets clearly have an effect on the wealth and the financial security of financial institutions, who are the ones missing from your graph.
Well, two things to say. It's not what you're saying, but one thing that one has to be very careful of. Some people sometimes, when they see my chart on debt, say, but Adair, what are you worried about? Because there's a whole load of offsetting assets. And it's a simple fact that at the level of the whole society, for every debt, there is a financial asset. And some people say, well, you know, why are you worried about UK mortgage debt? You know, there's debt and there's other people who hold money. But on that basis, you'd never be worried about any level of debt. Because even if debt was 1,000% of GDP, it would still at the net level be zero. Because somewhere there'd be 1,000% of GDP as assets. But it turns out that if we pile up these claims vis-a-vis one another, people with large financial assets and people with debts, for a variety of reasons, that can create a huge vulnerability, because they are apparently risk-free claims on income streams which cannot be there on that amount. The other thing to say is that Tim is quite right, and I didn't show the chart, but it is in the book. In addition to that rise of leverage of the corporate sector and the household sector, one of the biggest things that grew between 1970 and 2010 was a set of intra-financial system debts of one major bank to another major bank. And that's a really interesting thing. Well, why did we need that? We didn't have it in the 1950s, and by 2010 that was actually bigger than even the debt owed by the household and the corporate sectors to the consolidated banking sector. And that reflects the extraordinary explosion of the complexity of the financial system, which occurred after the 1980s with the development of derivatives and what's called a securitized credit, which I argue in chapter 6 of the book, actually, far from making the system more stable, the net effect of it was to make it more dangerously unstable.
Okay, well, let me take a few questions now. So I have a gentleman here in a red jumper, at the back there in the white shirt, and here in the brown.
Right. Thank you very much. My name is Gordon Bridger. I'm a retired development economist. Just two questions. I think you would agree that the fall in interest rates was generated by the huge surpluses in the petrodollar countries and later on by China. Since they're now running into balance of payments problems, do you not think that, well, this won't be a source any longer of savings, and how is that going to affect our economies? And secondly, should one not show a difference between internal debt, which is debt to oneself, and external debt, which I think we are very much more vulnerable of? Thank you.
Yep. Fine. Yep.
And Joe. You had your hand up first.
John Essex from Greenhouse Think Tank. You talked about the need for regulatory change of how you look at wealth, income and investment differently. Should we have a more focus on wealth taxation rather than income taxation as a result? And in terms of investment rather than the real estate or the consumerism, depending on what we choose to invest, those assets could become white elephants or stranded assets if we don't, if there are things that aren't consistent with a resource-constrained economy that deals with climate change in the future. So should we differentially tax those?
Yeah.
And in terms of your graph of financial intensity against growth productivity, how do you see that hump-shaped graph comparing to the productivity plan, Fix the Foundations, produced by George Osborne?
Okay,
we'll
just take one more.
Okay.
Peter Roscoe from Climate Change Economics Institute. Just developing the question that was asked earlier on, I think that's related to the risk weightings you talked about on banks' balance sheets. What's the process? How do you see the process there to develop those risk weightings so they do reflect the long-term real value of the investments? Is it something, for instance, the National Infrastructure Commission be able to input on?
Okay, fine. Yeah. Try far away. Why are interest rates so low? I think what is interesting is partly interest rates are low because in the aftermath of the crisis, central banks have been setting short-term policy interest rates low in an attempt to stimulate the economy. But there's clearly something else going on, because long-term interest rates are not directly set by central banks, but they have seen a remarkable fall, not just in the period since 2009, but over 25 years. And the measure of this is to look at a long-term index-linked by real return gilt. In 1990, a insurance company or a pension fund, which was trying to buy assets to match a long-term liability to future pensioners, for instance, could buy a UK government index-linked bond or a US government index-linked bond and could get a return of 3 or 3.5% real, absolutely assured, inflation protected over 30 years. Even by 2007, that had come down to about 1%, and it is now at about minus 1%. So we need a theory of what has occurred to this extraordinary big change in long-term real interest rates. And the hypothesis, the theory would tell us that this must be, or is likely to be, a change in the balance between ex ante desired saving and ex ante desired investment. Saving and investment have to equal each other as an accounting identity after the fact, but in the ex ante desired attempt to invest or save, there can be an imbalance which is balanced out by a move in the interest rate. Therefore, economists have a set of theories of where is an ex-ante increase in savings coming from, and they're talking either about the old savings glut hypothesis with, for instance, the very large current account surpluses out of China, or some set of things in demography, or some set of things to do with inequality and the high marginal propensity to save of increasingly rich people at the top end of the income distribution. And I think all three of those are probably at work. On the ex-ante investment side, there is a very interesting phenomenon going on, which I don't think we focus yet on enough. I mentioned it briefly, that the cost of plant and machinery relative to the general price level is falling. And there are IMF figures that show that down by about 20 or 25% over the last 25 years. And that reflects the extraordinary power of information and communications technology, which is a unique technology, both in the fact that the hardware capacity that it delivers tends to double for any given price every 18 months or so, and this extraordinary phenomenon of software, which is a technology where once you've made one copy of it, the next billion copies really don't cost you anything at all. And there's nothing like that in previous technological history. And these mean that the cost of capital goods, wherever they have within them a lot of information and communication technology, are tending to come down. And I think we have a lot of very big companies now which really don't have to invest anything like what equally big companies used to have to invest. I mean, Google has to do lots of investment, but relative to the investment we used to think was required of a company with an equity market value of $500 billion, its investment level is quite low because it's all software and there's just much less to do than when Henry Ford built his factories before he could produce Model T Fords. So I think there's a variety of things going on. I think you may be right that one of the drivers of the excess of ex-ante savings, which was the savings glut from large current account surplus countries, may decline somewhat, though China is still running a large current account surplus. Germany is running a large current account surplus. The petrodollar surpluses are clearly coming down, but I still think we have a lot of these going on. So I would not anticipate that we're going to see a rapid change in those long-term interest rates. And this relates to what's called the secular stagnation hypothesis and some of the long-term drivers at work. The internal debt versus external debt is important, but it's not the only important thing. I think it's important to realize that if the world were one economy, or if the UK were the only economy in the world, and there was just sort of desert in the rest of the world, it would still be the case that we could have too much debt, right? Particular problems can be created by debt which is owed to another economy, external debt, and there's a lot in the economic literature tended to focus on that, particularly with emerging markets, and particularly when that external debt was denominated in a currency other than the currency of the country. But we should not assume that the problems of debt go away if it is all internal. The dynamics of a completely closed economy with debt to GDP of 100% will be different from the dynamics of a completely closed economy with debt to GDP of 300%, so it's still important. On the issue of wealth and income, yes, on the whole, I do think we should shift a bit towards wealth tax rather than income taxes. I think it's, I didn't make myself popular with some people, but I did say before the election that I do think it's bizarre that what I pay in council tax is, not much more than people who have a house which is worth, a small fraction of my house paying council tax. Didn't necessarily want to go all the way as high as where the mansion tax was, but broadly speaking, the direction of change that we should somewhat more highly tax, land and wealth in its things, I think is probably a good idea, along with taxing environmental bads. Right, I think broadly speaking, we should try a little bit more to tax wealth, much more to tax environmental bads and adverse side effects. And if out of that we can afford somewhat lower taxes on, employment, that is probably a good thing. Investment can result in white elephants. You're absolutely right. I didn't explore this, but I explored this in the book. The ability of the private credit system to produce, even separate from your point of view about environmentally stranded assets, assets which once they're built are clearly unneeded is extraordinary. I mean, Spain was left by the pre-crisis credit boom with regional airports which have almost nobody in them. Ireland was left with about 30,000 houses in a population of only 3 million people, which are being knocked down and returned to agricultural land. The Chinese credit and asset price, credit and construction boom has resulted in large numbers of apartment blocks in third and fourth tier cities, which I suspect will never be occupied. So the private credit system is capable of roaring out of control in the upswing of the cycle when people tell themselves crazy stories about this time it's different and it needs to be constrained. Now, a particular subset of that is the one that you mentioned about, you know, stranded assets and carbon. You know, I think we've got to take measures on that. That's something on the climate change side of my head I'm interested in. I think we should undoubtedly, I think carbon prices are very important to that. I don't happen to believe, well, I think it's a simple fact. We cannot have a zero fossil fuel economy tomorrow, but we've got to transition out of a fossil fuel economy, and we've got to use a whole series of levers to do that, including significant climate change. The risk weights, the answer is I'm not sure. I mean, I'm simply at the level of saying, once you've accepted that you can have a carbon price, right, in the product market as a way of pricing in an externality, why don't you also try and affect relative prices in the cost of capital? And given that a lot of low carbon assets have a particular feature, which is all the expenditure is upfront in the initial capital, and then there's close to zero marginal cost of production, it means that changing the relative capital cost can be a very strong lever. Now, having said that, I'm cautious of handing to anybody like the Bank of England to say, oh, you start worrying about, you know, the green implications of this. I mean, they've got a big enough job just to do financial stability. So maybe this ought to come more through a green investment bank or an infrastructure bank saying, we are the public institution, right, which has, you know, a status and a degree of subsidy where we provide, you know, finance at a lower cost than it would otherwise be. And that might include a particular treatment in terms of capital, in terms of the financial regulation. So I have to say, you know, that is thrown out of as a logical thought, that once you've realized you should price externalities on the product side, you shouldn't exclude interventions on the price of capital. But I haven't a full worked out theory of exactly what are the institutional mechanisms best to do that.
Would you go so far as to say that you could use monetary finance? Would that be too Mephistophelian?
No. I think it is quite possible that within, you know, the crucial thing with monetary finance and why people are worried about it is that this medicine tastes too sweet, right? And the way I think about monetary finance, it is a medicine which taken in small and appropriate quantities is useful, and taken in large quantities truly is fatal. I'll come back in a second to the Michael Kumhoff point about early Weimar, but I think it can be fatal. And I think, I mean, Zimbabwe, I think, is actually a better example than Weimar in this respect. Therefore, you do have to say, well, how would you use it in a way which doesn't increase the temptation to overuse it and overuse it? And if you use it literally as a tax cut, and a tax cut running up to an election, I mean, you can see there are a set of political risks. I mean, the worry factor about this is significant. And therefore, saying, is the way to constrain it to spend it on infrastructure? And while we're doing that, should we spend it on green infrastructure? Yes, I think that is a real possibility. And for instance, within the Eurozone, where I think we do need a stimulus to nominal demand, which is not through yet more QE and negative interest rates, but where there are very strong constitutional blockages against anything that gets to monetary finance, I think within the art of the possible, something which involves the EIB supporting a large green infrastructure program and issuing bonds which just happen to be bought by the ECB could be an art of a possible for something which is quite close to monetary finance, but still works within the political dynamics and the constitutional limits on the degrees of freedom of the ECB. Just finally, on Michael's point, there is a fascinating argument about what really caused the Weimar hyperinflation. I think part of it is that the government was running fiscal deficits which are money financed, but partly it was that the Reichsbank had decided essentially a limitless process of rediscounting what it called real bills, i.e. Credits created by the private sector. And indeed, one of the best accounts of the Weimar inflation is a very old book produced in the early 1930s by a man called Constantino Bresciano Torani. And in that analysis of it, it is clear that although I think part of the story is that money finance deficits are going on, there is also a cycle where the central bank is, for whatever reasons, limitlessly underpinning private money and creation as well.
Okay, we've made you work very hard in this cerebral experiment of putting two sides of your brain together. The risk of taxing you a little bit, I did see there was one question there. Anyone else?
Yeah. Yeah.
Someone else? We'll take those three questions. So, Joe here first. Yeah.
Joe Holm from Ocean Energy Advisors. So my question was on the Green Investment Bank.
Yeah.
You mentioned risk weights, and they should not be entirely set by private institutions, and how public policy should favour debt and growth for sustainable sectors of the economy. Green Investment Bank, and indeed the European Investment Bank, could be an example of this.
Okay.
Is there a role for the insurance sector to receive positive intervention from government in order to stimulate the sort of growth that we wish to see? Okay.
And David?
First of all, thank you very much for an excellent lecture. I'm not really kind of a scientist. I'm looking also at future assets that are future assets which are hard to
quantify. Yeah. Right. Yep.
Thank you.
Yep.
Again, the other side of the brain that deals with climate change and thinking of future assets, how would one encourage, given the way that the current government views the direction of the GIB, how would you view where the
ordinary individuals could invest in these future assets, yeah, instead of simply going into a crowdfunding
project for real estate. So I picked up your comments
yeah
on the table yesterday.
And the gentleman at the back.
I just wanted to know, what's your take on the issue of US more or less suggesting some form of ways and means given by the central bank? What's your take with that and the independence of the central bank?
Yeah. Okay, did we go one more there?
Yep.
This chap. Yeah.
Simple question from a simple man in the street. Why do we target 2%? Why don't we simply target zero?
Okay, fine. Okay.
Which has been around for a long time.
Yeah. Okay, let me go in reverse order. Why do we target 2% inflation? And there are people beginning to question this now. Increasingly, when I was in Germany 2 weeks ago, I was aware that an increasing number of German economists, I think, are saying not that they contest the tool used to get to 2% inflation, but they're increasingly saying we're never going to get to 2% inflation, so don't even try. I think it's dangerous. I think there is a good argument as to why economies will tend to work better with about 2% inflation rather than about zero. Now, you can contest that. There is a paper from the Bank for International Settlements in March for last year, which draws a distinction between good deflation and bad deflation. And it points out that the British economy in the 19th century, which undoubtedly grew, had from 1815 onwards, you know, gradual deflation till about 1890. That was driven by the fact that the money supply was constrained by the gold standard, and gold was constrained by whether you discovered new gold. And for a long period of time, we didn't discover enough new gold to grow the money supply in line with the economy until the big discoveries in South Africa and Klondike at the end of the 19th century. So, yes, you can have a growing economy with mild deflation. However, that 19th century British economy was also subject to some wrenching cyclical movements. Cyclical movements which, in the absence of a government role, a Keynesian role in stimulating the economy, were only solved by significant downward flexibility in nominal wages, by which I mean, you know, workers taking 5 or 10% wage cuts. And I think you simply cannot, in a democratic society, a one-man, one-vote society, rather than in an oligarchic society where, you know, if the strikers don't like it, you shoot them, I don't think you can balance your economy in a process which requires wrenching downward movements in nominal wages. So I think the structure of the deflationary 19th century economy was dependent on a relationship between, as it were, working class and a bourgeois which was politically in charge, which is just, you know, is not the way we have it now, quite rightly not the way we have it now, and is unsustainable. There are also a set of arguments which basically say an economy needs to be able to have flexibility in relative real wages, right? It needs some people in some areas of the country to get slightly less real wages, others get more. It's very difficult to persuade people to actually take nominal wage cuts, but if you've got inflation of 2% and people are bluntly a bit overpaid relative to their economic value, you can get them back into balance with 5 years where they get no pay increase and it's fallen in 10%. And there is a sort of lubrication of the necessary flexibility of the economy by a degree of inflation. So that is why the world has, I think, quite correctly focused on the idea that we need about 2% growth. In fact, the 2% inflation. In fact, the biggest arguments after the crisis were from people like Olivier Blanchard and Ken Rogoff, who said that given what we've piled up this debt, we're never going to get rid of this debt without even higher inflation. And they were arguing that we ought to have a period of time when the inflation target was more like 4 or 5%. Central bank independence. I actually believe in central bank independence, and I think it is one of the things which can make money finance safe. If we did not have central bank independence, and we, as it were, took money finance out of the intellectual taboo box, I would be worried that over time we would overuse it and overuse it for political purposes. So my proposition is that you can give to an inflation targeting, such as 2% central bank, the authority to determine what is the maximum amount of monetary finance which is compatible with the inflation target. And to me, that's the anchor which makes it possible to use the monetary finance tool without opening ourselves up to dangerous political indiscipline. Future assets. I think it's clearly desirable for us to try to create opportunities for people to, you know, invest in things which are environmentally sustainable, which are, you know, as well as give a commercial return. And there have been a series of attempts to do that, to say that you can invest in these funds. They do depend on individuals then taking that decision. And unfortunately, unless you can get very large volumes, they tend to have higher administration costs than things like just buying the index. And so some people look at those and say, well, yeah, but I could buy in a sort of ecologically sound way, but, you know, the administration costs of doing it are higher. I say this because I had some money invested in an environmentally sound fund, and my managers, one of our big, you know, asset managers, just written to me saying, I'm sorry, the amount of money in this fund has ended up subcritical mass, and can you fill it in a form to say where you'd like it reinvesting, but we are closing this fund. So I think there's certainly very interesting ideas, and I'd like to think of them working, but, you know, they haven't been a very big part of, you know, the financial system so far. The Green Investment Bank, I just by the way, on the Green Investment Bank, I personally don't think it should be privatised. I think the whole purpose of the Green Investment Bank is to make a set of interventions in a controlled fashion which do things which the private sector would not naturally do. I can't see why you'd create a green investment bank unless it's going to do that, in which case I think it's slightly odd having investing it to immediately privatise it. Now, we think the crucial thing is to make sure that having been privatised, it doesn't just go off and just become another profit maximising bank. Its whole purpose is to do things which give a positive return, but which are, you know, pushing the frontier of, you know, doing things which we're also convinced are sustainable. As for the insurance sector, I'm actually on the board of the Prudential at the moment. I don't want to get too much into what the insurance sector, by the way, is multifaceted. It is at one level an asset manager. We own M&G asset management, and there I think the issue is these issues of, can you create, you know, environmentally sustainable funds, or can you, through your ownership of companies, be part of encouraging them to, you know, reveal their carbon emissions, the sort of stuff that's been done, I think, very effectively by the Carbon Disclosure Project. Insurance companies otherwise, you know, do a bit of managing money in a pooled fashion, in particular with profits. So the point about the asset management bit is they can do a bit, but at the end of the day, they ultimately provide a set of choices to people. They say, do you want to be in global equity index or global bonds? And they manage that, but they don't decide which class of asset to be in. Ultimately, it's the end individual or the end pension fund that decides which class of fund to be in. So that means that there is some leverage there, but not huge leverage there. When you get to things like the with-profits funds, which are pooled, you know, obviously they have to make intelligent decisions about whether there are investments which truly are going to be stranded, and are they thinking about, you know, the long-term economic prospects of that company, allowing for the potential adverse effects of future carbon prices. That's part of the thing. But at the end of the day, it's difficult for them to divert from a fiduciary responsibility to give a maximum return to the policyholders that have given them their money. Unless they've, you know, said, this is a separate pool of money which won't invest in these things and might invest in others. But if you do that, then it depends on the choice the individuals make.
There, thank you very much. In the spring of 2009, Her Majesty the Queen went to the London School of Economics and asked a bunch of economists why they didn't see it coming. There was a lot of humming and hawing, I think, at the time. And then several weeks later, a bunch of economists wrote a letter to Her Majesty the Queen saying that they felt that there had been a failure of some very clever people to understand the wider system risks of the financial system. The truth, writes Adair in Between Death and the Devil, is worse than that. The academic discipline of economics, to some extent, not only missed the fact that those things were coming down the line, but it was to some extent even complicit in the design of a financial system that led to that. And in the face of that, he makes a very strong argument in the book. He hasn't talked about it so much today, but he makes a very strong argument in the book, actually, for the renewal of economics, a different kind of economics, an economics more fit for purpose in the challenges of the world that we face today. And very few people, I would say, have done more towards creating that new economics, in particular in his role as chair of the Institute for New Economic Thinking, than Adair has done in the last few years. Thank you, Adair, for taking the time to spend with us today. We know you have a very busy schedule. As I mentioned, Adair's offered to sit and sign some books if anybody has books. If you haven't and would like to get them, I'm assured there's a stock in our own bookshop, which is just over there. And I would just like you to put your hands together to thank Adair for a very, very...